Welcome back, everybody, here to your coverage of the RaidCall EMS One Summer Group Stage, where we're looking to send one, that's right, only one of these two teams through to the LAN finals live in Poland. Netolic, are you? Will they represent Russia? Or will it be Flipsid3 being there to represent the Danes? Of course, they were there last time under a different name. Will they get there this time around? We'll find out together, hand in hand, strolling down the field of lilies. It is my current commentator and myself, the capitalist. What's up, man?
Toby, with the way you're going, I'm gonna start some rumors, some e-rumors.
Yeah,
going
yeah. Says the man who sees glitter popping out of Bear's wreck.
It was real. I'm gonna make a YouTube video clip. I posted on Twitter too. I was like, I'm not crazy. All right, the death animation, the bear flopped down on the ground, and then the resummon animation, its backside popped up, and then the resummon, right, has that little glitter, that the green stuff that pops out. It looked like he farted glitter. All right, I'm not crazy. It happened.
Screenshot or it didn't happen, man. Screenshot or it didn't happen. I want to see it.
I will leave this game and go through the replay right now.
I want to see a screenshot from, even if someone in the chat wants to help out Capitalist and actually make a screenshot of this, I want to see that thing on the top of Reddit saying, Bear farts glitter. That's all I want to see. Bear farts glitter. And that's all it needs to be. Reference, hashtag Capitalist, whatever. Yeah. Want to see it. Want to see it. Someone get a screenshot of that.
Nice. So I'm going to be a Twitch meme, and then I'll also be known for bears farting glitter?
That's, well, whatever works, man.
Went to the casting scene, baby.
Yeah. Gonna have your catchphrase somehow. Man, I remember back in the days when Capitalist used to have energy. He saw bears farting glitter. That were the days, man. They were the days. Whatever happened to the old Capitalist? He's just not like the new Capitalist anymore. Okay, talk about the game. Talk about the game. Talk about the game.
Yep.
Game. Uh-huh. Run us through the draft, man. Run us through the draft.
Netolic, Visage, Bane, Lifestealer, Storm Spirit. Flipsid3 picking up the Bat Rider, Shadow Demon, Gyrocopter so far, so they have a lot of really good team fight, a lot of mid game on their team, but they have to worry about the Nake Spawn. Netolic Russia, they're set up really well, really well. Their lane phase is going to go well for them. They've got a really aggressive. Now, I'm not a big fan of the Bane as a support mixed with the Visage. I feel that's very, very odd, but the mid game is going to be huge for them. They've got one of the big counters to Lifestealer Bane on their team, and they've also got a potentially really strong aggressive tri-lane, the Visage Lifestealer. Again, the Bane doesn't fit well into that, so it might just be a defensive tri-lane. He is sort of lacking in that regard when it comes to some damage that he can output for the soul assumptions. But the mid game, right? You've got Bane, you've got Visage Birds, you've got Lifestealer and Storm Spirit and Ace Bomb together. Very, very dangerous combo that's really going to be able to pick off some easy heroes. The team fight, though, is going to be very dangerous from Flipsid3, and they have to worry about that.
Yeah, that they do. Weaver is the last one. That was a very quick pickup. They knew exactly what they wanted coming into this, man. They've got some really great stability. They've got so many different options for jumping in, and they've got the makings of a beautiful aggressive tri-lane. Nyx and SD, they're almost too defensive in my mind. They're too defensive in the early stages. Up against a Bane, a Visage, as well as a Lifestealer up there. Leave Weaver to go one-on-one with what I would assume be a Batrider. Or in this case, now actually give me a Broodmother on the bottom lane, which puts Miguel into that middle lane up against the Storm Spirit. We're going to have ourselves some very interesting contests in the lanes.
Yeah, I like... A lot of teams have been doing this. They pick up Broodmother as their fifth pick when they determine the fact that the other team does not have any real AoE to be able to deal with this, because with the nerfs and buffs that Broodmother has received, she's much more of a high-risk, high-reward. She could push faster now than she ever could before, but it's more dangerous because you're giving away a lot more gold, a lot more spiders, and the gold bounty is much more. So in this regards, they don't have too much. They have, like, what, Lifestealer Infest, Storm Spirit with that Static Remnant. And there really isn't that much. Mm-hmm. So I like that pickup. That as a four-man crew, they're going to be very, very aggressive. They're going to try and force some team fights. Batrider's going to lead with trying to pick off a hero. That's going to turn into a team fight most of the time. And they should be able to stand up 4v5 against Netolic, looking really, really strong. And that's going to leave Broodmother just pretty much constantly pushing in a lane. If he has an Orchid, he's going to be a danger to both Storm Spirit and Weaver. And when he picks up that BKB, not only is he going to be a threat to both Storm Spirit and Weaver, but he's also going to be a really great anti-carry going up against the Lifestealer. He just latches on the Lifestealer with that BKB and never lets go. And with that 60% miss percent chance now from incapacitating bite and mixed in, obviously, with the Lifesteal, he's pretty much like Lifestealer's just out of the fight completely when the Brood jumps on him.
30 seconds. I kind of want to throw out Ryze's shout out to Susan Boyle. I'm guessing he's now found the new love of his life. I think she's a little bit too old for you, man. But then again, I heard today that age doesn't matter. So maybe give it a shot.
Uh-huh.
Her singing is crap, though. Moving on. So bad.
I had to look up who it was. I was like,
really? Really? Like, don't you follow the way that Simon Cowell basically bleeds the music industry?
No, I don't. I don't. I haven't had cable in a really long time, Toby.
You don't need cable. There's this thing called YouTube.
I don't have any form of television or anything I watch online.
YouTube.
And I refuse to watch reality shows, so I only watch good television. So there's that.
Well, like, man, there's reality shows. You watch Game of Thrones, man. That's a reality show right there. That's so reality.
I wish.
We got our lanes down now. So it seems like they want to zone the Broodmother out completely. There's already a Sentry Ward down there, so Unicorn's going to get no space whatsoever here. Weaver is here to go into the middle lane here. So Stork, we saw him part of the aggressive tri-lane in our games earlier today, and now he's up against Miguel as a solo mid. They sack the top lane by putting the Lifestealer into the jungle, and that puts the two defensive supports on the bottom lane going up against the Broodmother. This, I like the change. I like the change. I like also, too, Stalkers moving yourself back there. You know Miracle's going to just do that. Okay, so possibly could have delayed a little bit longer and waste a little bit more time of Miracle there. But there's 10 napalm stacks already from Miguel. Look at that range creep. It's basically coated in tar. It cannot get... like, every single crevice is currently being covered right there. And yeah. What Stork would wish is to have a magic stick with all that going out. And what is that? Courier! It's like Rhindon.
Oh, you haven't seen this guy?
No!
Yeah, he's pretty awesome.
He is gorgeous. Meanwhile, bottom lane, I should probably keep my eyes on Unicorn when he's on the other side of his sentry ward next to FNG. Who still, by the way, hasn't decided to level up an ability. Yeah, but this guy is so cool. His little flying things. It's like, what is it? Land Before Time? Like, the dinosaur book for the kid book?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Except that was actually real dinosaurs. I'm thinking about a different book.
Yeah, you are. I know what book you're thinking of. I just can't think of it right now either. Yeah. I have it in my head. But okay, so this is smart and I like it, and I'm also wondering if they're gonna switch up the lanes, because right now Elite, he's the only hero who can go up against solo versus the Broodmother, and they also have to worry about the Orchid. So here they're shutting that down, keeping the Orchid away from the Broodmother by shutting down an early laning farm, and they're also making sure that Storm Spirit, early on 1v1, he would get absolutely dominated by that Broodmother, but once he hits level 5 and level 6, he's good to be solo. So that at that point in the time, the supports can rotate out. Lifestealer's a really slow jungler, though. He's really, really slow. Yep. So I'm almost wondering if they're going to rotate the supports out once they've ensured Storm Spirit that lead in his lane that he will be able to stand up against. You look at Lifestealer, he's like... tanking. Oh,
yeah,
I see what he's doing.
He's doing the pull through. Yeah, yeah. He had to delay the creeps a little bit longer before they followed him out.
Smart.
Now, and that lets him jungle a little bit faster. But yeah, and we already knew that about Live Seals, where they are really, really slow. He needs some extra bump up, and that's why he's here on the bottom lane. They need to have a Nightmare. That Nightmare wasn't in range, and I don't know if Unicorn... Yeah, Unicorn could see him coming in. He knows that Netolic are looking to kill him on that bottom lane. So he has to be very, very defensive. And flip side, they also realize this. So what do? They get in behind that tier 1 tower in the top lane. They take out the creep wave, and this is the one with the catapult. So that means their catapult one is coming in right now. Exactly what they want. Force out this tier 1 tower life points, or force the rotation, which did happen. Three-man smoke move to the top lane. This is what I thought they were going to start with. But as you said, they needed time for the Storm Spirit to get up to level 5. He's 4.5. It's good enough.
Yep, and they still have a glyph, so even if they might let this tower go into deny
look at
range of the glyph.
Ryze, you can see him looking for him, but open wounds. There's that movement speed. Now I can finally slow him down. The sole assumption, Ryze, he will go down. Bane gets the kill with the brain sap. Now moves over to Mania. Mania being blocked up by his own creep wave. There's another sole assumption, and he can move over to Miracle, whose clarity will get cancelled off, and FNG gets himself a double kill up on the top lane.
And the tower's in deny range. Beautiful. That was pretty much perfect by Netolic. They let the tower get low enough, they initiated, they forced them back, even if they didn't get any kills there.
Oh, which Eli's in trouble. Eli's in trouble. Miguel's down. He doesn't have lasso, though. He's got himself a haste rune, but he's going to get pulled back in again. This haste rune is not going to last forever. He actually ended up taking more damage then than he actually dealt to Eli after rotating out the middle lane, where Stalker is still just basically playing with every one of his non-opposable thumbs and farming at the middle lane.
Mm-hmm. Well, CS, I'm really curious to see Weaver. Like, it's a lane that he can survive in, but I'm not surprised he's not getting too good of a CS. 17-2 versus 27-9 on Batrider. And that's just because of the turn rate. Like, he can survive in this lane just fine, but it's still really hard for him to be able to get all of those last hits up against Miguel with the way you can play really aggressive with that sticky napalm. Wow, they smoked up again.
Yeah, they want blood, man. They want blood. They walk underneath the Dire Ward. Now this could be a miracle. And Nightmare was just the open wound to start with. He's up for three way stun and doesn't want to use a Nightmare. First stun and then just, wow, that was a... Okay. Everyone takes damage. Everyone just gives soul assumption charges to the Visage. He's just like, 160 mana. I do more damage than anybody else on the map. What's up?
Yeah. Netolic, going out, Tri-Lane versus Tri-Lane, they should have been at a significant disadvantage. But with those two smokes, they knew they were at a level disadvantage because of the fact they had a jungle, gyrocopter, had free farm, all those sorts of things, actually.
Oh, Lifestealer, manning up. He needed a little bit more mana, though. He needed to have mana to have that open wounds plus the rage for to try and real man up on Mania. So he couldn't do it at the end of the day. Trace back the tier 2 tab, but look who's rotating top. It's a DD rune up on FNG as well as Android right behind him. And Mania, he'll spot him, but he's turned. Call down. Where's the Nightmare? It goes up on Mania. And then Soul Assumption. Got to keep that right click going. And Disruption from Ryze. He'll lose Susan Boyle Brown right now, but Debane.
Nice.
He picked the right one. He knew which one was the right one, too. And was able to get a trade off. Two supports for a gyro. Nah. Even. Even if Jara was the one to get... Did he get both the kills? No. SD actually took the first one. He got the kill on the Visage. And that at least allows Ryze to buy up boots. It's looking good.
Well, right now, Weaver... This game is going to be a tough game for Weaver, just because you have Nyx's Assassin who was able to initiate on him. You have the Broodmother who's going to pick up Orchid, and Batrider, big lockdown coming out from him. Also, there's a lot of teamfight damage. Like, there are two ways to deal with Weaver, right? You have the lockdown, and if you don't have the lockdown, you just have the teamfight damage. You don't run away from the Weaver, you stand up and you manfight him, and you have more damage than him, and you're fine. So, the flip side, they have a combination of both of that. So this is going to be a hard game for Weaver, and I was a little bit surprised he was picked up as that fifth pick for Netolic. Especially given the fact that he's already in a lane that isn't getting much farm. Like, he's really going to need Lincolns this game, and that's just going to delay his damage even more. And that's going to leave entirely up to Storm Spirit and Lifestealer then to be able to put out all the damage. And their combo is pretty much just meant for being able to pick off heroes. Like, initiating a team fight against a team that has some really good AoE, it's not going to go well for them. So they're pretty much just going to be using that to pick off heroes.
You know what? It's in breaks like this that I try and make the most out of my time. So I get that research. I get the information. From behind the scenes to bring to people in front of the scenes. And what I have for you is Ryze's in love with Susan Boyle.
Okay.
That's all I got. I have nothing more. Yeah.
Good insight, Toby.
I'm here for you.
Thank you. We had this long pause, and I thought you were going to bring us something to talk about.
Yeah, I don't talk about Susan Ball. I hate her.
Okay, so I thought the whole reason that they were letting Storm Spirit, they were keeping him bottom, right? Because he had the best spammable AoE ability to be able to stop Broodlings.
Correct.
Which was Static Remnant.
Yep.
He is going through traditional Storm Spirit build. Which, yes, he'll be able to survive in lane, but they still won't have much to be able to stop early Broodmother pushes. Now, as he gets levels, he gets level 14, 15, obviously, then he'll be able to stop it just fine. He'll be able to jump in and throw down dust and grab the Broodmother, and even if he doesn't kill her, at the very least, he'll be able to stop that push and farm up some of those Broodlings. But that 20-minute mark area, Broodmother's going to be really pressuring this bottom lane. And again, there isn't much on Netolic to be able to stop that. So they're really just going to have to focus on being able to win these 4v5s that Flipsid is looking for.
That's a pretty rough ask, man. That's a pretty rough ask. Going to win a 4v5 up against a Batrider who has no Blink Dagger and Raw Boots? Okay, maybe it's actually not that hard to ask. Quite possible. You are right. Like, I'm really surprised a Storm Spirit isn't just like walking around with, or like having three Sages Masters already. You get these things up and running so you can spam your ability. So you got a good regeneration as opposed to just going this Null, Talisman, Bottle, Treads. You need your attack speed, obviously, but you can't sacrifice everything else. And okay, he sacrifices attack speed. He goes Arcane Boot. So his way of spamming it, which really still makes me ask a question, is he going Orchid or not? Because Orchid regeneration's enough that Ops has the need for Arcane Boots.
Yeah, this is really weird. Like, if you go Arcane Boots, that's usually because you wanting to go Bloodstone.
Yep.
You pick up Bloodstone, you break apart your boots, and then you get Power Treads for later. So this is, I don't know, this is weird, and I'm not sure if I agree with any of his decisions, but it's still viable, because the fact that Storm Spirit is still able to survive in this lane just fine, and he also has
lane.
Kill potential.
There goes your dust. Yeah. Pull in Unicorn. The Spiderling's blocking out a little bit faster now with the Soul Assumption. Again, that's so much damage from Android. He's going to get rid of these spiders, though. Very, very quick. Let's look at the dust on them so they knew exactly where they're walking. That was a good gank. But now he's out of mana. And you see his regeneration. It's nothing. He could just be thinking about like the mid-game. Thinking to like 25 minutes, 30 minutes in, which is very unusual for a Russian. And I say that in a really nice way, too. I say that in a really, really nice way. I love
middle,
watching the Russians
life
play.
Stealer.
Yep. Look how fast you can move when you tie a Shikuchi. And then into Miguel. Straight up into open wounds. FNG was behind again to steal another kill. How many kills did he manage to take? He's 5-1-1 on this main.
Oh, this is one of those good support games.
Kill secure.
Like, whoops,
extreme.
I got another kill. Oh well, guys, I guess I'll just be able to have upgraded boots early on.
It's all for his BKB, man. He's going raw BKB. Plan, successful, strike, go, GG.
Unicorn is not doing well at bottom whatsoever, but he's getting to that point. He's now level 5. He's going to be able to snowball out of control soon. Even if he doesn't have to worry so much about the static remnant, he still has to worry about the overload combo, not feeding away too many spiders. He needs to start throwing those spiders into the jungle and picking up extra gold there.
Secondary sentry. Unicorn is really backed into a corner now, and they're going to see him. Storm, he's not wanting to jump. He's wanting Unicorn to overcommit himself a little bit too far. And that means
Unicorn
the creep wave is going to push out for that then. Well, Unicorn can't really know. And if you look at the mana pool of Storm Spirit, he doesn't have enough for a jump and a pull. A jump of that range, he doesn't have enough. He needs Unicorn to come in close to him.
No, he knows because they threw down the counter ward and the creep started attacking his spiderlings.
Ah.
So unless he didn't see that happen, he should absolutely know. They've got some stacking going on. Flipsid is farming up a nice little hard camp. They're actually spinning it together, which is really smart, especially for Nyx Assassin. Shattered Demon doesn't necessarily need it. It's nice. You get a whole new level of kill potential when you have that purge. But Nyx Assassin is really the support that's going to be suffering here. He really needs to be level 6. So maybe he even should have just stayed in lane and picked up that farm.
Yeah. He needs all that level 6 is meant to be coming so they can gank up their Storm Spirit so they can shut him down. Or look for the Lifestealer before he rages up. Or before he finishes up an armlet, which now with an infest, what's flying out in couriers, a couple of sentry wards. This is just Stork being bait. That's all he is here in the middle lane. It's like, yeah, Weaver's been farming up here the entire time. What you gonna do? You got Nasty who's hanging on top of a tier 1 tower. They know what happened last time. They knew there was a gank that happened and came out of nowhere. I don't know where the Lifestealer is, but then again, no one ever does. He's been inside the jungle most of the time.
Yeah.
And now Batrider. This could be the worst time for him to have a Blink Dagger. He'll see the Weaver. You see Weaver's positioning. You could say this is just posturing and trying to be aggressive, but at the same time, you could also say, this is so obviously a bait. It's not funny. And FNG, nightmare. Put it as quickly as he could up on Unicorn. He's got to get himself out of this, out of the spiraling army, and then a pull in, pick up, throw down. FNG, he's going to move away a little bit further. Eli, that wasn't the plan. But it still works. You lose. Actually, how much gold did he take for that one? Not as much as I thought. Bane mustn't have had a big killing spree. He must have died like once in between like that those five kills.
Yeah. They're wasting a lot of time here. If the Batrider never jumps the Weaver, this is going to be great for them.
Oh, they found him. Run around the corner, and then he just blinks up.
Miguel's the smart player. He knows what's up. He knows that this Weaver's being way too aggressive, and he's already had that Lifestealer pop out once on him.
Mm-hmm.
I think he knows exactly what Netolic is going for here, and he's just going to play passive, he's going to try and defend his tower, and let Netolic waste a ton of time. Like, this is like 2 minutes worth of time where Lifestealer's been sitting on this Weaver, just waiting for this bait.
It's no hands Dota, but it also means no omelet Dota. He needed that kill. He really, really needed that kill to make up for that time waste, as you're saying. But it didn't happen. And I'm wondering for Flipside. Like, how do they really make an opening out of this, though? Like, Lifestealer, sure, he just wasted a crap ton of time. He now falls very, very far behind as far as, like, gold per minute's going. But you look at the Storm Spirit, and he is now building into that Orchid. So we're wearing the Arcane Boots, and he's not going Bloodstone. He's still going to go straight into that Orchid. Which means aggressiveness on this bottom lane. At least got some really cool regeneration coming his way. Good harassment over towards Unicorn as well. Just keeps going with these Static Remnants. Farms up those Spilings so quickly. And these guys stop being fed by Unicorn. There's just so much bonus gold coming the way of Eli. Like, his CS is through the roof at 93. A lot of those being Spilings. But at the same time, those Spilings are worth a crap ton more money than they used to be.
Yeah, absolutely. It only takes like three. You get like three of the small little spiderlings, and that's pretty much worth a creep. And when you're talking about him probably having a good 30 extra CS from that, mm-hmm. that's a lot of gold. This early on in the game, 12 minutes in the game, 10 extra CS pretty much. It's very, very large. But Broodmother, again, he's doing the right thing. He's throwing him into the jungle and trying to pick up the extra farm there. And Nyx's Assassin actually coming through here. They're going to see if they can gank the Storm Spirit, which will be huge.
He caught a glimpse of him. He's staying with him. Yep, Blink Lasso. Nice. Vendetta attack as well. Going to have to follow up with an extra stun Spiderlings, and they have more than enough damage.
I was a little bit concerned about the Nyx's Assassin lack of mana. But with Miguel coming in, they knew they needed that. They really needed that kill, and they made sure that they got it with the extra teleport in. So, and again, wasting time, Netolic. They go in for another Weaver inside, or Lifestealer inside the Weaver, try and go for another Infest Bomb like that, and go through the enemy jungle. No one's there.
10 seconds, they can do it again, though. All it is 10 seconds. Now, 1 second, 0 seconds. Give the TP over to Stalk, let him TP down that bottom lane because that T1 tower is going. This becomes a T1 for a T1 trade. And Lifestealer is sick of being inside of him. So just attacks it down, gets the last hit in the tower, it's going to work nicely towards having that full armlet. But it still is a trade. No matter how we look at this, it's a trade. And it's a big trade too because Mania is also picking up an ancient stack. With this will be his level 11. It's going to take him a little bit longer because he doesn't have Lifesteal. And that means he's not going to be here to help push out to another tower, while the rest of Netolic, they're looking for a Tier 1 and a Tier 2 tower. Storm jumps in, Unicorn, he just wants his spiders, doesn't even want Unicorn himself. Dire's yep. middle tower has fallen.
Well, they lost their Tier 2, but honestly, that's fine. They need to make sure that they can really win these team fights. So Flipside is going to focus on getting their BKB first up on Gyrocopter. Batrider, preferably you'd like to have Force Staff. He's actually already got the recipe, so he's closer to it than I thought he was. Still about 1,100 away.
Mm-hmm. Once he's got that, then they got to change him in position. They're going to have to move themselves up to that top lane. Flipside smoke to move bottom lane. They want to get a Tier 2 tower. They're looking to trade and again try and shut down this Storm Spirit, which can buy up majority of their second Oblivion staff. But I won't say surprisingly, because he looks like he's wanting to have money in case he needs to buy back Sentry wards are down on that bottom lane. Miguel searches for him. And then a quick jump away. It's very obvious Miguel was going to do that. The second he popped off that Firefly, we'll hold the creep wave out. And they've lost the T1 tower now in the top lane. Because Flipside, they're poking and prodding, but not with all heroes. And Weaver's got to make a decision. TP bottom lane. There it goes. Double TP. They get the pullback on the Nyx Assassin. And that's Nyx dead. Out they pop. Nyx Assassin just dies to the creep wave that was there in the tower. And everybody comes back. But then, all the flip side into the T1 tower. It really feels like we're playing Ring and Ring of Rosie, man.
Yeah. And eventually this is gonna go away the other way, right? Eventually Flipside is gonna have the farm that they need. And they're actually gonna be the ones chasing Netolic.
Oh, there's familiars. They're looking for the extra stuns. They're gonna find one here on Rise. Drops down, and that's after he did pop off the purge. But it's gonna be easy enough for Lifesteal to finish the job, and there goes Bane. That's a quick pop on the Bane. And one more attack, able to get that kill, but there's no infest, there's no nothing like that. So call down, Rocket Barrage, and very quick death. Storm Spirit, in he goes, and out he pops. He does not want to be part of that one. He doesn't have an Orchid available. There's a Rocket on his tail as well. Blinked down by Miguel. He just wants to slow him down. Now the Weaver Bugs are on their way here. Miguel's overextended himself. Where's the Grave Chill? Gonna slow him down. That's the work. Into the Soul Assumptions. Now the Batrider overextended. 10-6 on the board.
Yeah, both teams getting too aggressive there. I mean, that was just Netolic diving in way too far. Lifestealer ended up trading himself for a Shadow Demon. Nothing that you want to see, ever. And then Batrider just going way too deep. That being said, Unicorn is still farming at the bottom. Jungle and the lane at the exact same time. He's going to be able to pick up an early Orchid, but the fact that he hasn't picked up any of those items yet, like, normally you can get, because Orchid's a really easy item to be able to farm up, and Broodmother is also kind of mana dependent, so you normally see those staffs being picked up fairly early. But he isn't, so that almost makes me think maybe he's just going to go, like, straight BKB and try and participate in these team fights, which would be a little odd, but I don't know, it's just weird he's holding on to so much gold when he could use those stat items right now.
Well, let's get into it, man. Elite, let's put that Orchid to use. Looking at the top lane, jumps up. Mania already into a BKB, and then Lifesteal's like, okay. We want to fight this one. Ryze coming in. Mania will actually use his BKB to TP out as well. And Batrider, jumping bottom lane, FNG. Fiend's Grip possibility, but while Unicorn's in the neighborhood, he's not going to do it. And now Android, there's your Fiend's Grip. Flame Break gonna cancel off. There's enough time for the Soul Assumption plus the Brain Sap to repair the damage done by the Batrider. And now in comes Miracle. Starts up on Android. In fact, gets the kill on Android and stuns up the Lifestealer at the same time. So we'll have Stork chase down Miguel. At the same time, Miracle is being chased down by Lifestealer. Open wounds, familiars in front. First stun, second stun, and then death. And Batrider, it's coming back over again. He ends up just going up for the rune, which is not there. So 2-for-1 trade. Visage for a Brood and a Nyx.
And bad trade all around. The gold lead sitting about 1,500 for the Radiant. Same goes for the experience lead. But Flipside is still getting there. Jump in, top.
Yeah, that's Miguel. Easy Orchid. And they'll pop from the Orchid, let alone that last attack from Elite. Very simple, easy snipe off. And this is Flipside. I don't want to say they're losing control, but it's definitely shifting to Netolic. It's definitely shifting to Netolic. And if they don't put the reins back on this horse right now, they're going to get trampled. You already see Lifestealer coming off, so D-ward of a D-ward. And Stork still finding his farm on the bottom lane. Walking around, recipe away from Lincoln's Fear. Miracle wants to initiate him, but there's a Sentry Ward. Nightmare goes down, Nightmare was taken off, and then a full double stun coming off, hitting both the Lifesteal as well as Android, but he's still got that Soul Assumption. They already got the kill out on the Nyx Assassin. Dust popping off too, time-lapse out. Nicely done there from the Weaver, one more attack, he'll pick off Unicorn. No he doesn't, Unicorn's getting lifted this. Now Miguel, Fiend's Grip up even though he got the last two up on the Lifestealer. Lifesteal now comes down that one, but Rice, Disruption, buys some more time. Miguel wants to get away, Bane with the right click, takes him off, and Lifestealer leeching faster than he's dying at the tower. Not to mention a good armor toggle, make sure he stays alive. And Unicorn, well, he was lucky to survive through that one. The rest of his teammates, not so lucky.
Well done. That was just really good play there by Netolic. They countered every single thing that Flipsid threw at them. First with the counter ward to take out the Nyx Assassin. Then the Bat Rider trying to jump in gets countered by the Bane with that good Fiend's Grip. All around, there were just lots of really good little plays there that pretty much countered every single offensive ability that Flipsid went for there. And because of that, they not only win the team fight, they're going to take the tier 2 and take control of this game. Like, just winning that team fight, there can be better items picked up on Flipsid. Like, they don't have their BKB yet up on Unicorn, which is still very, very interesting item choices. Forest Staff could be picked up on Batrider, but that wouldn't have, none of those items really would have changed the team fight. It still would have gone the same way. And now Flipsid, they're going to be playing scared. They're going to be trying to keep up the farm. They can go late with a gyrocopter. You can always go late with a gyrocopter, but they are going to have a really hard time because you've got, well, you don't have the hardest carries in the world. You've got Lifestealer, Storm Spirit, and Weaver all being some really good softer carries / semi carries, and also Bane and Visage, some really good late game supports.
Ryze in trouble, Mania as well. They're coming in to try and counter off this. And Mania had to pop the BKB. Ryze realized he was dead instantly. And Mania says, well, we're playing Left 4 Dead. That's exactly what happened to him. And they'll clean up the rest of this ancient stack. Or should be cleaning up the rest of this ancient stack. But they're not. They're going for Roshan. Suppose one prize is bigger than the other, and with a Medallion of Courage, it won't take him long to get through this Roshan.
Yeah, if Bane had it as ultimate, it was actually like 2 seconds away from being off cooldown. That would have been 2 kills.
Miguel, is he gonna? No, he's not. Static Remnant gave him the Flying Vision out of the pits. They realized who was coming at him. And Storm Spirit, well, maybe he did realize. It's a long jump up, finds Mania, pulls him in, but Batrider, Blink Lasso. Well, there goes Aegis already, but no one the good news already. And he'll have to jump up again. They keep the vision on Mania, and there goes the jump. Pull him back, no BKB available. And this is definitely a Russian way to use an Aegis the Immortal. You instantly get it, you use it as bait to catch out one of the carries. And then ping the tier 3 tower in mid saying, let's go.
I mean, they're losing their tier 2, so why not? They should push in right now before the gyrocopter. I love the fact Lifestealer is going to go for a Basher here, and then he's going to probably go for that split build where he also goes a Hyperstone. But this Nakes Bomb is now become so much more deadlier because now BKB can't save you. Once you have the lockdown of a Basher on that Lifestealer, they have both the physical and magical lockdown.
Why isn't Gyro bought back? They could have bought back and fought this 5-on-5, but instead they're happy to let their racks go, knowing there's going to be an infest just TP back to base. Like Eli, Miracle Stun! Gonna cancel him off. Lifestealer could still jump himself out of this one. In fact, he will have to. There goes your damage. Soul Assumption thrown out of Miguel. Eli stays alive. Disruption saves Miracle is that little bit longer. And now Mania wants to fight this one up. Miracle comes back in again. Vendetta hit, but Lincoln Spear able to trigger. The cooldown's going to be there. Miguel, he actually managed to get the lasso up. But look at that armlet toggle with the stick charges as well. Mania, too much damage. There goes the Susan Ball loving Ryze. And then goes to Mania as well. Soul Assumption has his death too. What could have just been if they let him TP out, we're happy to let the melee Rex go, will now be a range Rex going down and the rest of Flipsid again.
And Broodmother, all he took was a tier 3. This game's pretty much over because now they're going to be able to take at least the tier 3 at bottom. If not the Rex, and once 2 Rex is down, it's pretty much over. But just taking the mid allows them to control the map, and from there, they have a much easier time versus a Broodmother.
Mm-hmm.
They only have to worry about a safe, two different side lanes.
Unicorn wants to fight up right now, and there's a little bit of trouble here for the Lifestealer. He's still got that armor toggle to work with, but Unicorn, he's just used his BKB plus Insatiable Hunger and hardly even attacked throughout the entire thing. Miracle inside the Spire Caravans, it does not care for a raged up hero. And Broodmother lucky to get away. Ryze will not be as lucky. Familiar's right behind him. One more attack will do the job. And a jump in by Eli. Miguel pulled up, pushed down, thrown out, and just killed. Now over to Mania. His fly cannon doing his job. Now to give himself a double kill, but Stalk right behind him. Throws at the Weaver Bug. Oh, Storm is him. Double kill for Eli. And there's actually a DC out already. Gyro has left the game. Mania DC after picking up the double kill. I haven't seen a GG call come out just yet. The rest of Flipsid still fighting on.
Well, Mania was the one not buying back earlier, so I don't know. But Eli, Like, I don't remember how you say his name, but the Lifestealer is doing so well with those armlet toggles, and Eli is playing out of his... Harkon. All right, and Eli's playing out of his mind on this Storm Spirit, so...
Yeah.
Really well-deserved game one.
That's also his Bloodstone, too, if you look at him. He's got enough money to just walk over the side shop and pick up his Bloodstone. Desolator's even up for the Weaver. There's that reconnect. That's the reason why they didn't pause it up, because Jara was he was dead anyway, so DC'd out during it, came back up by the time he was alive. So Flipside haven't given this up just yet. But they definitely need some huge amount of damage. And I'm looking at Mani to do it. He's got 2,800 gold. Even just picking up a Demon Edge, it doesn't need to be a Monkey King bar. In fact, it kind of feels like it has to be a Rapier. But at least he keeps his options open by having that Demon Edge. There's some more damage. There's a semi-ancient set here. It's very, very little for him. But it's at least something. And now, it looks like are they grouping up for a five-man grow up? What? I don't even know what that was. That wasn't even a word in English that I was attempting. Five-man push on the bottom lane. Yeah.
It's their only option. It's winning a team fight inside of Netolic space. Dire's top tower has because right now with two racks down, there isn't really any other option. What's interesting is Gyrocopter, he didn't have any sort of big item incoming. So that whole buyback situation, it's not like he had a big item that he was going to be able to grab. So...
Netolic trying to force top lane Storm in, he goes Mania BKB and hello Lifestealer, he got a bash on him too. It bore the time for Stork to do the damage and then moves over to Miguel. Batrider, one more attack, there she flies, he goes down. Now over to Ryze, Gozit will save his life for a little bit. Shikuchi through, looking for an extra one. And Ryze, well, one attack and done. Triple kill for Stork. This is GG. There is nothing that Flipside can do to stop this at all. In fact, you're already seeing Dota Stork starting up on the tier 4 towers in the mid. So Netolic, they're one win away from Poland. At the same time, Flipside, man, they've definitely got schooled in this early set of the game, man. Netolic have been on absolute fire today. Absolute fire. Their aggression's been good, their coordination during the T5's been superb. I want to give them all the props in the world I possibly can. They're looking great. They're looking like a strong Dota 2 team.
Yeah, the thing you were talking about with, you know, the Phantom Lancer. You don't have to worry about the Phantom Lancer illusions, just worry about the Phantom Lancer.
Yep.
But Netolic had the exact same philosophy with the Broodmother. They didn't have much to be able to deal with the push of a Broodmother. They just consistently ganked her from time to time. And that was enough to shut her down. Unicorn didn't have anything.
Mm-hmm. And that's meant to be the power of the Broodmother. You get shut down the early stage, you're basically destroyed. The power of the Broodmother is pushing down these towers very early on. Like, we were looking at the draft from Netolic saying, hey, aggressive tri-lane, that's definitely what they're searching for. And they said, you know what, we don't need an aggressive tri-lane at the very, very start. We need to shut down the Broodmother in the early set so Storm Spirit's got what it takes that he can survive and also compete on the lane. And then when their rotation happened and they did run that aggressive lane up to the top, the rotation timing was absolutely perfect. They caught out Flipside when they were overcommitting on a tier 1 tower because they thought no one was going to defend it, so they were playing very, very carefree up there. And man, they better find that care factor. We're going to be coming back here in a couple of moments' time. Game number 2 of this best of 3 matchup. Will it be a Russian team being the next one to go to Poland, or will it be a Danish team? Stay tuned, you'll find out.